Hi everybody. In this video, we will continue to talk about how quantum mechanics works. In the previous video, we introduced the Schrödinger equation and we introduced the idea of wave functions. But we still didn't really get down to the rules of how quantum mechanics operates. In other words, if an object is in a certain wave function, we didn't really talk about what happens when you try to measure a certain property like position or momentum or energy. In this video, we're going to talk about the postulates, the rules that govern quantum mechanics. And there are five of them. The first postulate is something we've kind of talked about already, the idea that the position and the momentum of an object can be fully described by its wave function. What we haven't really talked about yet is that there are certain conditions that dictate whether a wave function is acceptable. To summarize these conditions, the wave function basically has to be a mathematically well-behaved function, because the Born interpretation of quantum mechanics tells us that the square of the wave function is proportional to the probability of finding a particle there. We can infer that the wave function has to be normalizable. In other words, we have to be able to integrate this probability to 1 over all space. And also, the wave function has to be single-valued. Because the Schrödinger equation has a second derivative in it, and we have to be able to take the second derivative of any wave function, we can infer that the wave function and its first derivative both have to be continuous. In other words, the wave function has to be continuous and smooth. Probably the easiest way to wrap our minds around all of these conditions is to look at some examples of wave functions that are not acceptable by this postulate. If we go through these wave functions one by one, you can see that wave function A is not continuous, wave function B is not smooth, wave function C isn't single valued, and wave function D can't be normalized because it goes to infinity. So all of the wave functions that we'll come across in this course have to be well behaved, continuous and smooth and single valued and normalizable. The second and third postulates of quantum mechanics are pretty dense, and they really start getting into the rules of how quantum mechanics operates. The second postulate tells us that every observable property, whether it's position or momentum or energy, corresponds to a linear Hermitian operator. And the third postulate tells us that the only possible values for us to measure when we take a measurement of an observable property are the eigenvalues of the corresponding operator. There's a lot to unpack here. First off, we should define what we mean by an eigenvalue and by an eigenvalue equation. An eigenvalue equation is one that has the following form. Some operator applied to a function is equal to a constant times the same function. In this type of equation, the function is called the eigenfunction, and the constant is called the eigenvalue. This is a very general type of problem, and it's one that we'll see all the time in quantum mechanics. And actually, we've already seen an example of an eigenvalue equation. The Schrödinger equation itself, h psi equals e psi, is an eigenvalue equation. The Hamiltonian operator, which is the energy operator, applied to some wave function psi, is equal to a constant, the measured energy, times that same wave function, psi. The Schrödinger equation is the quantum mechanical equation that's specific to energy measurements, but there are operators for every property. There's an operator for position and an operator for momentum, etc. This slide shows us the one-dimensional operators for position, momentum, and energy. You can see that the energy operator is the Hamiltonian operator that we've seen already, which can be split up into kinetic energy and potential energy, where the kinetic energy term is negative h bar squared over 2m times the second derivative, and the potential energy depends on the chemical environment. The position and momentum operators are both pretty simple in one dimension. The position operator just says that we multiply x by our wave function, and the momentum operator is negative I h bar times the first derivative. In each of these cases, and when we take any measurement in quantum mechanics, if we have an object in wave function psi, and we want to predict the outcome of a measurement, all we have to do is apply the corresponding operator to the wave function and find the eigenvalue. For example, if we apply the Hamiltonian operator to a wave function psi and the result is 5 times the original wave function psi, what that tells us is that if we were to take a measurement of the energy of an object in wave function psi, then we would, 100% of the time, measure that the energy of that object is 5. The measured value of that property is equal to the eigenvalue of the operator that corresponds to that property. The second postulate also had one more big math word in it. It said that every quantum mechanical operator is what's called Hermitian. The definition of what it means to be a Hermitian operator is shown here. It's an operator for which, if you take this integral shown on the slide, and you switch the order of the two functions, psi I and psi j, the value of the integral stays the same. I don't want to dwell so much on this formal definition, but for our purposes, there are two important consequences of the fact that every quantum mechanical operator is Hermitian. First of all, for a Hermitian operator, all the eigenvalues are real. This is important because, as we said, the eigenvalues are the values that we actually measure when we measure, say, the energy, the position, or the momentum of an object. And when we take a measurement of a physical property, we would hope that the values that come out are real. The fact that the operator is Hermitian guarantees that they are. Another property of Hermitian operators is that all of the eigenfunctions are orthogonal to each other. That basically means that the functions are perpendicular to each other. The definition of orthogonality is shown at the bottom of the slide. If you take the integral of two functions multiplied together over all space, and it comes out to be zero, then those two functions are orthogonal. As we'll see later on, it's important that all of the eigenfunctions of a given operator, of a given property, are orthogonal to each other. That's why, for example, all of the atomic orbitals of a given atom are orthogonal to each other. Since we'll be seeing a lot of eigenvalue problems in this course, I want to give us some practice. So let's consider the following operator A, which we're defining as the second derivative of a function with respect to x. If we're looking at this operator A and each of the following functions f of x, let's answer these two questions. First of all, is each function an eigenfunction of this operator A? And second of all, if it is, what is the corresponding eigenvalue? I'll give you a few seconds to think about this, and if you'd like more time, I would encourage you to hit pause and take whatever time you need. So the question we're really trying to answer here is, if you apply this operator A to a given function, is the result a scalar multiple of the original function? The first function we're looking at is f of x equals x cubed. The second derivative of x cubed with respect to x is 6x, and if you compare 6x to x cubed, they're not scalar multiples of each other. So what that means is that x cubed is not an eigenfunction of this second derivative operator. If we consider the second function, f of x equals e to the 3x, and we take the second derivative of that, what we end up with is 9e to the 3x, which you'll notice is just 9 times our original function. So that means that yes, e to the 3x is an eigenfunction of this operator, and the corresponding eigenvalue is 9. And finally, let's look at the sine function, f of x equals sine of x. If we take the second derivative of the sine of x, we end up with negative sine of x, which is just negative 1 times our original function. So yes, sine of x is an eigenfunction of this operator, and the corresponding eigenvalue is negative 1. So far, we've talked about the outcome of measurements when a wave function happens to be an eigenfunction of a given operator. To reinforce this, let's think about this particular example. Suppose we have a property A for which we have two wave functions that are normalized eigenfunctions. The function shown in blue, which we'll call psi A, has the property that if you apply this operator to psi A, you end up with 1 times psi A. And the function shown in red, which we'll call psi B, has the property that when you apply the operator to psi B, you end up with 7 times psi B. So, if you measured this property A for a particle in state psi A, what do you think its value would be? And the same goes for a particle in state psi B. What do you think its value would be? Hopefully you remembered that the outcome of these measurements would just be the eigenvalues corresponding to each eigenfunction. If you measured property A for a particle in state psi A, you would, with 100% probability, measure a value of 1. And if you measured a particle in state psi B, you would, again with 100% probability, measure a value of 7. But an object isn't necessarily always in an eigenfunction of the given operator. Now let's think about a different possible wave function, which we'll call psi c, that itself isn't an eigenfunction of operator A. It's a sum of two eigenfunctions. We're defining psi c as 3 times psi A plus 1 times psi B. And you can see a picture of what this function would look like. So the question is, what do you think would happen if we measured the value of property A for a particle in state psi c? What values might we see? Well, one important thing to remember is that the third postulate of quantum mechanics tells us that the only possible outcomes are still the eigenvalues corresponding to the eigenfunctions of property A. So because psi c is just a sum of two eigenfunctions, psi A and psi B, the only possible values that we might measure are the eigenvalues corresponding to psi A and psi B. So that's 1 and 7. So you may be wondering, which is it? Is it 1 or 7? And this is really fundamentally the strangest thing about quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics tells us that we can only think in terms of probabilities. If an object is in state psi c, and we measure the value of property A, we might measure the value 1, we might measure the value 7, but we can only know probabilities. And those probabilities depend on the coefficients of each eigenfunction within psi c. In this case, you may notice that psi c has more psi A character than psi B character. It's 3 times psi A plus only 1 times psi B. And as a result, we're more likely to measure the eigenvalue corresponding to psi A. In other words, we're more likely to measure the value 1 than we are to measure the value 7. In general, this gets us to the idea of superpositions. A valid wave function doesn't have to be an eigenfunction of a given operator. It can be a sum of eigenfunctions, which is what we call a superposition, which isn't an eigenfunction itself. So in general, we can define a wave function psi as some coefficient times the first eigenfunction plus some other coefficient times the second eigenfunction, etc. And what we've just learned is that, first of all, the only possible measured values, if we measure the value of a property, are the eigenvalues corresponding to psi 1, psi 2, etc. The eigenvalues corresponding to the eigenfunctions of the operator. That's what the third postulate of quantum mechanics tells us. And if our superposition psi is normalized, it turns out that the probabilities of measuring each outcome are proportional to the squares of the coefficients, c1 squared, c2 squared, etc. We haven't really demonstrated this last point here, but we'll spend more time on it in class. We're almost done. There are just two more postulates of quantum mechanics that I want to briefly mention. The fourth postulate tells us that if an observable property is measured repeatedly for an object in wave function psi, then the average value is given by this integral, the integral of the complex conjugate of the wave function times the operator applied to the wave function integrated over all space. We just saw that in general, the value of a measurement might be different each time, but if you took that measurement a large number of times, then the average is given by this integral. This type of integral is called an expectation value, and we'll see plenty of examples of it in class. And finally, the last postulate of quantum mechanics tells us that a wave function evolves in time according to the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. The forms of the Schrödinger equation that we've seen so far, and really all the forms that we'll cover in this class, are the time-independent Schrödinger equation. So I include this last postulate mainly for completeness. We won't talk about it much. So that's all for now. We've learned in this video more or less how quantum mechanics works. And in the next video, we'll talk about a few of the strange philosophical implications of quantum mechanics.